Hospitality Sea Academy, always putting a spotlight on the startups. And since 2012, we are now over 600 startups and 7,000 community members. We focus on five main sectors, and we just added a new one this week, so it's kind of exciting news. We focus on autonomous and connected urban mobility, shared mobility, electrification and energy, and drones and aviation. And we are glad to welcome this week the maritime community, which will be added to the EcoMotion community to see how we can also enhance and help Israeli technologies in this space, since you know ships are becoming as well autonomous and electric, and it's a major footprint, so we're super excited about that. So 6 months already with this subject, this buzzword, blockchain, what does it mean? And how does it meet mobility? It's been quite an interesting journey to find this out. When the Amazing Connect group spoke about their blockchain vision, and to even have someone, Benjamin, which will share with you soon their vision, which is head of blockchain in a major group, this is super interesting, and to see that blockchain is really becoming a part of the community. Afterwards, you'll see from a tier one point of view, from an entrepreneur point of view, from an NGO kind of startup-ish point of view, and we'll try and understand what is this decentralized network, blockchain, and all these buzzwords have to do with mobility. So I'm here like you to sit back and learn and explore this interesting subject. I'm super happy to invite to the stage Stephanie Heyman, which is Managing Director of Connect with the Volkswagen Group and our co-host and collaboration partner today. Thank you so much for hosting us here, and congrats on this beautiful space. Thank you, Olivia. All right. Good morning. It's actually our first event here in our beautiful space. We're very excited to just launch Connect with Volkswagen Group, our innovation campus here in Tel Aviv. And we already had a nice gathering here together, and I thought I need to introduce a little bit more what also we as a Volkswagen Group are doing here, who we are, and what the setup is. So I will show you in a second a little movie, actually from the EcoMotion, where we launched Connect. So it's been a great cooperation already with EcoMotion. So we'll introduce that a little bit, and then I speak about it, and then we head over to the next point. So let's start with our great movie, which is actually also brand new. So.
Volkswagen Group are big believers in the technical innovations that are coming out of Israel, and the Israeli startup ecosystem is just the spirit and the energy and the culture that exists here. It's unbelievable. It's really like nowhere else.
Connect is a unique innovation campus in Tel Aviv. Our main mission here is to build a bridge between the Volkswagen Group brands and the Israeli innovation ecosystem. We're scouting for solutions. We're organizing business events, and we're forming strategic partnerships.
And now, with the creation of the Volkswagen Group Campus, we have all the brands, all of us, an opportunity. We're gonna be together under the same roof. We really believe that going for open innovation and doing it together is an opportunity for all of us.
We're working here on topics around vehicle connectivity, smart mobility, blockchain, and cybersecurity.
That's one of the fastest moving and most interesting startup scenes for us, because there's such a sense of urgency, such a sense of getting things done in Israel, and especially in Tel Aviv and the startup scene here.
I'm very delighted that we finally found our home base with Connect with Volkswagen Group.
We as Škoda Auto believe in partnership and collaboration. Connect is a great platform for us because we can connect the old-fashioned automotive industry with innovative software and hardware innovations from Israel.
We want to connect both worlds, the corporate world and the startup world, to work together and to find future mobility solutions.
I'm looking forward to meeting you here. Later, for Connect, for Tel Aviv.
our CEO here last week, and this is just the start. So what we're doing here is, today is one example. We're bringing together the corporate world with the startups. But what we really want to emphasize is also we're here for our group brands, so we're bringing the experts. One day, or one week, we have a whole group of 15 people here working on blockchain, blockchain and mobility. Another week, we have over months, another project team here sitting together. So it is really the gateway for our brands to come here to work with you, with the startups. So it's a different concept, and this is why we also say this is a campus, because what we're also saying is it's a place of learning. This is why we have come here, because we're saying we need to learn from the best. We as a Volkswagen Group, we can't do everything ourselves. So this is why we also said, okay, Tel Aviv, the hotspot. And today, seeing you guys here in the office, in our office, which we've just opened, and it hasn't been very long. It's so excited. Exciting, and yeah, I think we're going to have a great day, great morning, and we should actually do this more often, I think. What do you think? So,
yeah.
We have more meetups. Great. So we will actually start with our colleague from Volkswagen Group IT. He's the head of blockchain. We brought him in just for 24 hours. I have to emphasize that, Benjamin, because you came just for 20 hours. You're even missing the German football game. Do you know how much Germans like their football team? So yeah, let's do this more often. Let's connect with us, with the team. We're here in our office, so we'll have a little bit more time of mingling afterwards. So I'm excited. I'm happy that you all came. And let's have a good breakfast talk, good conversation about blockchain meets mobility. I think this is a great combination, interesting topic, so let's do more of that. And please welcome Benjamin, thank you.
It's really an honor for me to be here, even only 20 hours at the football game. I told my friends, could be two options. It's the last football game from Germany in the World Championship, so that would be no problem to miss this tomorrow. But I assume it's only one of the games coming in the future, and the other I will not miss. It's for me the first time here, but due to that, I think it will not be the last time here. We already talked about that, to connect deeper also with you, with interesting startups. And now I want to share with you our vision of blockchain in future mobility. Yes, I started to work in Group IT last year in August on blockchain, interested in that, I think even 1 year before, but deeply involved and deeply working on that with a small team within Group IT. It's about 1 year since August last year. 2 weeks before, we had the exhibit CeBIT, one famous IT fair in Germany, where we shared also this vision, and it's an honor to share this now with you. Coming from the physical world, where it would be very easy to transfer money from me to Stephanie, to you, without any intermediary, so peer-to-peer, to the digital world, where it's easy, like you do now, you're creating content, and it's very easy for you to multiply and to share this content with thousands. If you would do this with money, it's not a this way where we need for money transfer. So this digital world with a peer-to-peer value transfer is a challenge in the digital world, or was a challenge in the digital world, and blockchain solves that. Why did blockchain solve this? First, with blockchain, all the parties get transparency. For example, transparency where money is, or transparency which data is there. We get also immutability, so there's no possibility to change the history of transactions or history of data in blockchain, and with that we get digital value transfer peer-to-peer. And what does this mean for our vision, the vision of autonomous payment? I brought some videos to you to share what we think. So if we face a world of autonomous car, we want to enable our autonomous car to do services for you and paying autonomously for these services with their own money, so that the customer is fully free of that. And this is a video from Seabed where we build up a module world where you can see it very clear. And the feedback was really impressive from the customers. Can you take the next video? That's 3 months. Even though the car, when it has its own border, it can also do services for you or for the owner or for the company on the car. So the vision is we give our cars a clap on the back at the end of production, give them their own money, and they go out and earn money and do services for the customers, for the owner. And using blockchain is even easier also to build an ecosystem where, in this example, we can include also private persons to take part with, for example, a private solar plant to charge our car there. So to connect all participants at an eye level. So we have our autonomous cars, we have entities, and we can connect also this private person with a solar plant, and to make the barriers lower, to work together and to enter the space. This is our vision. So the vision is a little bit ahead, and now I want to tell you how we work to reach this vision for you. So I brought some proof of concepts we are working on, and this proof of concepts are in different stages. What you can do really with blockchain beside this vision, and also to learn some things about blockchain. Because one thing you have to take in mind, that blockchain is a space where all technologies of IOTA, Ethereum, Hyperledger, all those technologies have their advantages and they have their challenges. And you have to learn about which technology fits for which case. And starting with the digital access control, so not taking money as a value, we take our access to the car, so the car key is a digital value, the digital key, and the owner grants access, in this case, to another person, and it then goes to the blockchain, and it's written there, and it's distributed to all the network, and so the car knows about who has access to me when. The car needs only one time access to the internet to get this information. And then if the owner wants to open the car, it's even possible in an offline solution. So we divide a decentralized access control with a direct control. This project was announced in February already from the Porsche guys, together with a startup based also in Germany named Xane. So we work with different parties on different solutions. So the second case, I think most of you know about blockchain and supply chain. We built up this based on IOTA with our cars. So a connected car sends its location during its logistic process to the blockchain. And due to that, we have first an immutable track But most important is to have this transparency for all participants in this supply chain, for the vessel operator, the ports. And interesting was, the first idea was to have this transparency for vessel operators, ports, and so on. And when we worked together with our departments, with logistic department, with purchasing department, we figured out that during this process there are a lot of discussion or disputes between two parties. For example, we have, if you have a long trip for the car, you have imports a charging procedure because the battery are lower, lower, lower. And in this charging procedure, you have a charging service provider, and we as the owner of the car want to pay them. And with this solution, the connected car, we can have the information if the car is charged or not in the blockchain, and there's no discussion between the two parties if the car is charged or not, which car should be charged or not. And so that you get more of a process efficiency and you work at an eye level together. So we get transparency to all participants and we get the right state of the car, and this leads also to a customer value, that the customer gets more transparency, where is my car on track or not. Together with the colleagues of research and development, we built up a tamper-proof documentation of software versions within our cars. So imagine you have a full autonomous car, but over the air updates and there's an accident. You or we want to prove as a company which software version was on this car, and we want to prove this public. So we have here our update process, not changed, but we implemented a connection from the car to the blockchain where the car sends, and the car sends not the full software version. There's only a hash needed to put the hash into the blockchain, and with this hash we can prove that our data is the right data. So we have a public proof of data integrity, and this is really something very interesting for us. The digital car pass, so a digital history of all the car data, even interesting for buying and selling cars. We use the same procedure in this example for fighting odometer manipulation by sending mileage into the blockchain. So the car trips, it's running, and after every trip, we send, also in this case, we do not send the real information to blockchain, we also send a hash to the blockchain. The customer has its real data, all my trips, this mileage, and in the blockchain, the hash information. And when the seller wants to sell its car, for example, if I want to sell my car, I disclose my data to you with the information of blockchain where this data hashes are placed, and then we have an app to evaluate if this mileage is true, and you get a record of this mileage with green flags for all the data you found in the blockchain, and then you are sure that this is not manipulated mileage. And for this, we have already agreement to make this to a product, and we will go to customers in the beginning of 2019 based on this. So important is that we learned about it. This we built on IOTA, and we have challenges there. And together with the guys from IOTA, we addressed these challenges, and we do not change technology. We know that every technology has its challenges, and we work together with them to solve those challenges and then have a better technology than before. And this is important for us to work together, to have partnerships and really work like partners. here. And with this, we increase immutability of vehicle mileage for our customers. Last but not least, our colleagues from financial services, together with the startup Motionwork, are building up an electric vehicle charging protocol based on blockchain technology. And this brings partners in the EV charging together. So today I need several cards for several charging port operators. And in the future, you bring these operators together and they work at an eye level together. And the customer has only one app and can address all these issues. And this project will go in the test phase in the next months in UK. There we do a great testing how this works with the partners together. We have two partners on board, three are in the onboarding process already, and after that we want to go to market with this as well. And for me important is to take into account we have a technology with challenges and with advantages. And we have not only the technology, we have only the way of work. So with blockchain you work more at an eye level together, and it's easier to bring partners together because every partner has the same information, the same transparency, and there's no big partner as a leader and smaller partners. That's very important. So thank you. This was based on the Energy Web Foundation Ethereum. So question, is this on a public blockchain? Depends. So the consensus mechanism is permission, so proof of authority, but the ledger is public. So.
Will this be integrated? Will this be integrated in the OICP protocol or OCPP protocol, or is it a different initiative?
I can't answer this question. So sorry. If you have detailed question, I can contact you to the guys.
Questions? Hey, sir.
I think yes. The question is, we are open what our customer needs. So there could be a customer like my kids. They want to have their own vehicle, autonomous driving, that they can say drive me to my friends. There could be other, for example, my wish would be a smart city having its own fleet, not providing streets, providing mobility and skip out every private transportation. And all of that we are looking what is the right initiative and why technology. And our smart city guys are working with us close together to exchange what they need and what we can do with blockchain.
All these solutions, actually, all these applications have been done without blockchain. So why you see that? What is the enabling point of this application is the blockchain? Because everything has been done without blockchain.
First, public verification. So
that without blockchain. I think we can deserve it, but we are doing that.
There are some things easier with blockchain than without blockchain. I think
that's so easy.
There, even Bitcoin you can build up with a central instance, but maybe it doesn't work and scale like Bitcoin scaled in the past.
As I understand, the big problem with the blockchain today is the time the transaction takes. So, if we have thousands of transactions in each minute or each second.
Regarding scalability, we have two things we think will solve that. First, the IOTA protocol won't have this issue in the future due to its scale with one transaction. You can approve two transactions, so this would scale and you have no transaction fees. And on the other hand, if you look in the Energy Web Foundation, Ethereum, there you have a network using a different consensus mechanism to solve this too. And you're right, you have to figure out what is the case, how many transactions do you need, and is it reachable for that? And we will learn. And we try to build our projects that it's easy to switch the technology behind. So if you build this trusted mileage, for example, sending to IOTA, it would be easy to switch to another technology or to IOTA version 2 or something like that.
In the TAMP group documentation for software, in that concept. So I just would like to know who takes part in the consensus forming process? Because you're using it to identify software that the correct code is in the vehicle at the time, or what code is in the vehicle at the time. So who participates in consensus in that case?
We use public blockchain, so IOTA. And what we do is the update process is a peer-to-peer process between car and company. But what the car does is every time when you switch on the car, it records its software information via a hash in the blockchain. And then we can identify, for example, as well, if someone tuned its car, it's also written in the blockchain, and we can prove that this software version we have in our database written this software version on that car is the right information, not the right software. This is not the thing we want to solve. We only want to prove that the information in our database is the right information, that no one can come, yeah, you could have manipulated this software in your database, or a third party could have manipulated that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Senior Technology Scout at Bosch to talk about the rise of the machine, distributed ledger use cases in future mobility, and to give us a perspective of the Tier 1.
So first of all, an important note. I'm from Bosch, I work for Bosch, but the future use cases that I'm going to present are my opinion and where I see that the ecosystem is moving, and I'll be able to take questions about it, but it will not be the official Bosch answer to that, okay? So, I would like to talk today about distributed ledger use cases in future mobility, and I have very good questions here regarding why do we need this blockchain? Blockchain is not good enough. So in Bosch, we're talking about the distributed ledger, which is the list that is managing all the transactions. And there are a lot of edge cases that we see in Bosch, which cannot be solved in a traditional database. And the edge are micro transactions on distributed areas that needs to get a consensus, and over there we see a good solution or an easier solution when we use a distributed ledger of any kind, each one of them with its advantages and disadvantages. So a few words about Bosch. Bosch is a global company that is dealing with mobility solution, industrial technology, energy building, and consumer goods. Most of you know Bosch from the consumer goods, but we are the biggest still one for the autonomous, for the vehicle industry. Most of our income comes from mobility solutions. We are also very innovative, and from Statista we see that Bosch broke most of its leading in the numbers of patents for autonomous vehicles. On December last year, Robert Bosch Venture Capital made its first investment in distributed ledger technologies when they purchased Toyota tokens to support the creation of new business models for the Internet of Things. That was kind of the second cooperation of Iota with a big German corporate, and I think that the first one where a German corporate actually bought tokens. This involvement in the process of purchasing tokens. So what is our motivation in Bosch going into this distributed ledger technology? So we believe that decentralized platform will generate these innovative markets and will maximize social welfare. And Bosch slogan is invented for life. We believe it actually will improve the lives of people. When we look in Iota, we saw the possibility to lower the hurdle for new businesses to emerge. Bosch is also the biggest developer and manufacturer of sensors. So I guess that around this room, we have hundreds of Bosch sensors in your mobile phones, in your cars, around you, Bosch security, etc. And the ability to generate long-tail marketplaces will allow most of you to enjoy the data that your sensors generate, but it's not mobility, so I will not focus on this area, even though it's a very good lecture on its own. So we would like to lower the hurdle for new businesses to emerge. We would like to enable the machines economy and enable new forms of shared economy. We would like to see new forms of decision-making and negotiation processes. And long-tail marketplaces and long-tail data businesses. The first use cases is in autonomous driving. So over here, I would like to elaborate on wallet-based coordination between autonomous agents. We see that cars are going toward complete autonomy, and you know, anyone that has a child here, the first thing that you buy to your child when you want him to be autonomous is you give him a watch and then you give him a wallet, you know, so he can take care of his own needs and later on maybe trade a bit. Or so autonomous car is not different than a child. Cars will eventually, I believe personally, the cars will eventually need a wallet. An interesting use case for that is it enough in autonomous, when we develop autonomous car technology, is it enough to sense the environment in order to be able to actually drive autonomously. When we're driving, there are actually three processes that we are doing seamlessly. First of all, we're sensing the environment, and over there, Bosch has a lot to offer with a lot of sensors for autonomous vehicles. After we sense the environment, we develop some road experience management. So I know that you are here, I'm here, I see another lane, and then I understand that this lane next to me or for cars that are coming in the opposite direction, so actually it's not an option for me to go there. And then there's a driving policy, so I want to speed up, I want to take a right turn, a left turn, and over there there's a lot of negotiation, so I'm pushing and being pushed back, and this is where it's really getting difficult for autonomous vehicles to move forward. I personally believe that execution of driving policy may benefit from distributed ledger micro payment based negotiation and compensation system. So this system should be fast and transparent with pricing model that reflect the true transaction value. So on top of being able to pay for parking and pay for electricity, if I need to take a right turn and I will pay you to let me in front of you because it costs you something to wait for me, but for me it's like very urgent to take this turn without braking, if I would pay you for that, it would be easier for you to accept my aggressive behavior, and over there we can get an easier consensus. Second use case for micropayment is an automated platoon. So we have the Bosch vision for future trucks. It's going to be electric. We're going to drive in platoons. as some of them are going to be autonomous. So what is Platooning? Platooning is the use of communication and sensor to virtually connect two or more trucks together in a convoy. So in all researches, we saw that 65% of rides can be platooned for trucks. 4% of a reduction of the total truck consumption can be achieved if they will drive in platoons. And I believe that off-chain micropayments can become useful method to enable the platoons economy. So the third use case is an autonomous junction. Today we waste a lot of time in junctions, waiting in red lights where we shouldn't wait. So the future junctions are going to be coordinated. They're going to be pre-coordinated before you go into a junction. You'll get a slot to go in. They're also going to be really flat because we do not need complicated system when we coordinate the traffic. So over here, I'd like to finish by showing a very short movie, how will platooning, autonomous coordination, and negotiation between cars looks like in an autonomous junction.
Now you see the protocol flying out with micro payments and managed to protocol by now with micro timers and emergency services. The protocol with emergency services, in what way? And how do we see that?
How do you see it? Forward,
yes.
So how will that play out in emergency services?
Emergency services like what, like
police vehicles,
so a lot of things happen when you have great plans, but you know people are also jumping in the road, and you have animals that are not coordinated in the system. So I believe that the first use cases, like my colleague from Volkswagen said, are going to be like city centers, which are going to be limited only to mobility services without like private cars in there. So you're talking about actual implementation. So I think that it would, personally, think it could take time. And, you know, edge use cases are yet to be dealt with.
Thank you, Dan. Now, I want to welcome Talat Tal, co-founder and CTO of DAO, which we count as a startup in our community, but they're actually an NGO. Tal is going to talk about how creating a transportation coin. Thank you.
Hey, good morning. As she said, I'm Tal. I'm from the DAO Foundation. I'm the CTO and one of the co-founders. DAO is a non-profit organization opened about a year ago to create a decentralized marketplace for transportation services. As I said, we started a year ago, and we've quickly grown to about 18 employees, 18 of them here in Tel Aviv. Just this week, we finished a crowd sale in which we raised $24 million. Which will allow us to operate for the next few years. So what is DAO? DAO stands for Decentralized Autonomous Vehicles, and I would like to focus today on that first part of that, the decentralization, and specifically what it takes to create a decentralized marketplace for transportation services. So why do we need a decentralized marketplace? Let's start by looking at something that started off centralized and became decentralized, and that's the internet. Specifically, the internet in the late 80s, early 90s. Back then, we had a bunch of closed silos like AOL, Prodigy, CompuServe, closed silos that created a curated experience with their email service, their weather, their email, their users, their login systems, their billing. They controlled the entire experience. And by the way, when I created this yesterday, naturally being a procrastinator, I went and checked out what's happening with our CompuServe today. And turns out they're still online. This is their website as of July 26, 2018. This is their weather service. And when you click on their homepage on what's new, this is what you see. That's a homepage of one of the internet giants from the 90s. In 2018, and this is what happens, and this is what you get when you innovate in style, when you're not open to outside innovation, as Stefan said, which is so important to be open for outside innovation, because not one company can build it on. So let's look back at the early 90s, where a number of standards came up for defining how to find pages, like URLs. You had standards for connecting a series of hypertext pages to each other using those URLs. And when you connected all of that together with standards that came before that, like TCP/IP, we had the open internet and the World Wide Web. And with it, a wave of innovation, new ideas, new businesses, and it was really one of the biggest revolutions in the history of mankind, and it happened because of decentralization, because suddenly anyone with an internet connection was able to innovate, to create something new, to publish content, to develop an app, to develop a service. There were no gatekeepers, no one controlling who could do whatever they want. Anyone could move it from a dorm room, from a garage, or from their parents' office like I did back in the 90s. And that's what we're trying to do at DAF for the transportation sector. We're creating an open platform that is fully open source and creates a common standard for transportation. A platform that allows vehicles, users, services, and infrastructure to work together in a decentralized way. This is Priyanka, one of our advisors, and she said, I think she sounded really well. She said that DAV is to the future of transportation what TCP/IP was for the internet. And I think that really sums up the kind of level we want to be at. We want to be this catalyst, this platform that enables other businesses to innovate on top of, to get this open platform where anyone can build the next big thing without any gatekeepers and without any silos. So to explore how we do that, let's look at what it takes to create a marketplace, even a centralized one. So let's say a passenger wants to get from point A to point B. First, that passenger needs to be able to find all the drivers around them, needs to discover them. Then it needs a way and a common language to communicate with them and agree and negotiate to the terms of those services. And finally, it needs a way to know who they're talking to, whether they're trustworthy, sign agreements with them and transact or pay each other. Today we have all of that as one closed system, services, web apps, applications that offer the entire platform, from matchmaking to route planning to payments, the whole thing, and they control the entire experience. It isn't open to outside innovation. So what we're looking to do is create all of this in a decentralized way, not in a silo, but completely open in a way that cannot be controlled by one player and doesn't have any gatekeepers. And that's what we're doing. So this January, I was actually in Moscow, and we did our first delivery drone test flights. I was able to order a drone from my phone to come to me, pick up a package, deliver it to its destination, and I paid for that using DAV tokens, which is a new type of cryptocurrency specifically designed for transportation missions. This is what it looks like on the blockchain. The tokens were deposited into the drone's wallet, and you can see it here. So what does it mean for a drone or a vehicle to have a wallet? Well, the logical conclusion, the logical next step, is to allow that drone to spend money. So last month, a drone in Berlin broadcasted the need for charging services. Charging stations around it responded, and it negotiated with one of them and signed a smart contract on the blockchain for those charging services. When it finished charging, it took off, and DAV tokens were transported from the drone's wallet to the charging station. And what we've done here basically is it gave a vehicle a way to earn money and spend money, just like Tal from Bosch said, which is a really important thing. And like, this really blows my mind. I mean, it's not enough to just give vehicles the way to go from point A to B if they always have to go back to their home base to recharge like a Roomba, if they're not able to be truly autonomous and find the services they need and consume them. So what's the solution? Does each company need to deploy a network of charging stations, a network of service centers, cleaning centers, mapping, route calculation, all of that? This would create a huge upfront cost for new companies who are trying to enter this field and would really stop innovation. What we need is a common protocol that lets any vehicle discover any services around it, lets it communicate with them, negotiate for those services, lets them pay for those services, all without requiring any previous business arrangements between the two companies. And that's what we did here. The drone was owned by Copter Express, a Russian company, the charging station by Skysense, a German company. A third company that recently launched on the network is from the US, offering route calculation services. And they were all able to work together. So that drone can do its mission autonomously because it buys the rock population services, so their engineers don't need to develop those algorithms. It is able to fly longer and cover longer distances because it is able to tap into a network of charging stations, and it is able to provide services and get paid for those services. And all it takes to accomplish that are the tools for those drones and vehicles to discover each other, communicate with each other, and pay money and earn money. So that's pretty much it, but I know I talked a lot about very futuristic sound things, like drones and autonomous vehicles, things that seem very far away in the future, although they aren't really. But this same technology, which one day will be used to allow an autonomous vehicle to be truly autonomous around the city and connect drones to last-minute delivery robots, it can also be used today to connect drivers and parking spaces. It can connect passengers and taxis. It can connect electric vehicles to charging stations. The opportunities are really, really endless here. And personally, this is what's most exciting for me, because we're building a platform that is open and anyone can innovate on top of it. So we really have no idea what the first killer app will be. That's something that will come from companies like yours. And I would love to talk about that later. Well, the issue of coin volatility is something that we prefer not to tackle, because we're not here to control the price of the token, but to create something that is a utility, and we're actually classified by the Swiss regulator as a utility, which is why we're not tackling that. But when you have a coin that is separate from the rest of the crypto economy and has widespread use, will have more stability, we hope. And also, this is about user experience. I mean, I've said this before, but we're not crypto purists. So when a person here on the street wants to buy a ride, he doesn't need to understand cryptocurrency. He needs to see a price in shekels or dollars or euros. And that is actually something where a company can come and provide that service on top of the DAO network. They can build an app that provides an amazing user experience that connects drivers and riders and allows users to pay with their credit cards, and they'll perform the transaction in the background. That's an example of one service that can be built on top of the network. I'm sure there's many others we haven't thought of.
So today, infrastructure is funded by our taxes, people. Machines, drones are going to be using our infrastructure. How does that transaction work? You mentioned infrastructure early on. How would then that relate to the city who has to fund and provide roads, landing space, or whatever for the vehicles? Where does DAV move 18th century infrastructure, if you really want to call it that?
Well, as it relates to the payments for using those infrastructure, I mean, that's an issue we're all discussing around autonomous vehicles and, you know, the resource of the curbside that needs to be paid for. That is something that needs regulation, and when that regulation comes, it can be supported by DAV, because those contracts between the vehicle and the passengers, they can include more than one person, more than two parties. They can include the vehicle, and they can include the driver, but they can also include an insurer, an arbitrator, someone who might want to buy some of that data. It can include the city, who will take a small part of that. And you can code all of that into a smart contract. So it's very good. But again, there are still a lot of unknowns in this field unrelated to what we're talking about.
Today he will share with us his experience with Calco-based blockchain POC that he did. Wait.
Hello everybody, good morning. So yes, it feels a little bit like a dinosaur being made for 4.5 years, because when we started early 2014 to talk about blockchain mobility, there was practically no one to talk with, not in the mobility sector, but also not in the legal aspect. It was an unknown field for many. So that's where we started, just like very short time when you look at just 4.5 years, but the acceleration that happened in this industry is just amazing. You couldn't have a room like that, you know, 10 o'clock in the morning, in a midweek day to have something like that. So that's just an intro. So we started with Lazuz 2014, pushed that forward. It was a carpooling application tried to build over the Bitcoin blockchain. No one was talking about blockchains back then, it was Bitcoin 2.0. And after nearly 2 years, we put that aside and the team kind of everyone went his own way. And I kept on trying to push another, something similar but different with EcoMotion. I was part of the third batch of EcoMotion with a little bit of a different approach, but again, mobility and blockchain didn't work as well, and I left that for a year. And mid-2017, about a year ago, a bit more, April 2017, Chris Bollinger was back then the head of mobility services in TRI, the Toyota Research Institute, contacted me and asked me if we would like to join into their initiative trying to build some kind of a blockchain community for mobility. And the idea was pretty simple, and I, as much as I love that, really, and even try to help as much as I can with their approach, the thing was that in order to create a real change in an industry like the automotive industry, as strong as a startup you might be, and well-funded, and great team, and so on, you need some kind of a backup from the big players. And just to create a common standard, common standards for new technologies is something that is very hard to implement coming bottom up. And it's possible, it's probably has been done before, but it's complicated, much harder, and probably will take much longer. So it was very appealing to join into something like that. Today, basically, that initiative became MOBI, it's the Mobility Open Blockchain Initiative, having quite big names into this consortium of mobility and blockchain. Toyota, in a funny way or not, is not part of that, but this is where it started. And our part in that was creating a carpooling application, a POC, basically a proof of concept, to show that we can actually create a carpooling application that is look and feels like a regular application, exactly like the guys from Dev is trying to create. Like, the user shouldn't have any weird things on his mobile app to ask for a ride. But the backend would be completely decentralized. And I say completely, it's always something very, you need to be very careful with that, because nothing is really fully decentralized these days. There's a new term I've just learned a few days ago, is a MVC, a minimal viable centralization. I think that's a very good thing that we should all bear when we go into blockchain. We still have a lot of value coming from centralized entities, and we need to see how these are combined together.
Very good point.
But,
very good point.
But we have tried to create, not my point, but thank you. So we have tried to create an application that basically had, we used React Native for the front end, so it's a very common developer tool to create apps, mobile apps. And at the back, we use Ethereum as our blockchain infrastructure. We use IPFS, the interplanetary file system, for keeping our decentralized users' data and the car's data that we have uploaded into this. It was just a POC, so we uploaded a few, you know, details, no real users at that time. And a click on Whisper, which is a peer-to-peer communication layer that works on top of Ethereum. So, and it was working. It was working on the Ethereum testnet, and we had a token inside, of course, that you could pay with, because it was kind of a test, so we went with a kind of an innovative approach, and instead of actually paying the drivers, we offered them to join some kind of a lottery at the end of the day. So you basically accumulated all, because we thought, well, for $10, which is the average price you get for a ride, you know, in the Valley area, going into San Francisco from Mountain View, that would be about $10 for as a carpooling driver, if that's what you would get. But then instead of getting $10, you can put inside, you can either take it or you can put it in your pool, and then it would make some kind of a decentralized lottery at the end, and someone can actually gain 5,000 or 50,000 US dollars, depends, you know, how many rides, of course, were taken in his community. And that's also a vehicle to create network effect and so on, which is the great thing that you can do with crypto economics. So that's basically the story about this POC. We ended that November, around October, November 2017. We announced that during Consensus, one of the biggest conferences in the blockchain industry. It was a big buzz, but funds were not exactly there. And I think also there's still a lot of things to do in this space of mobility and blockchain. There is a big future for that. I think that is, again, I would say that being great job, but for myself, I left that after really 4 years in this industry and working on a blockchain thing, but completely different. So that's it. Any questions?
You have to build a network of partners, including big partners and new startups. You need to integrate the point of disruption inside your company, where you consider the productivity point. We just saw with Tal how to think about a token economy. A token economy is not that easy to integrate. You have to think if your company can use it, if you can sell, if you have values, if you have something to sell to your clients, and how to integrate. Again, it's all about considering a strategy. This strategy is leading to many points inside the company. Do you have a culture? Do you want to get started from a trust point of view? Do you understand how much you're going to be exposed on a public ledger? Are you ready to open your ledger to the public? I'm not sure that most of the corporates are ready for that, because it has to be a long-term philosophy, and you have to consider again how you're going to interact with your partners. Do you have a cross-functional commitment? It's not easy to integrate that. Do you have a playbook about the digital asset that you have in your company? All these questions are the basics of how you're going to integrate the blockchain. Another point that I've seen, you know, for the past 12 months is the risk management. Everyone is talking about crypto, everyone is talking about ICOs, everyone is talking about, yes, I'm going to have a wallet. But how a company can handle a wallet and secure it and get started, you know, to work with it? That's the main question. How am I going to exchange my values with others if I don't have any money? So many companies started to make ICOs, but what is the real value of an ICO? Do you know at least how many times it takes and requires to a company, a corporate, I'm not talking about a startup, to make an ICO on one product? And how much money you have to involve, how much people you have to involve and invest. It's not that easy. So everything here has to be governed, well-driven, and considered, I mean, way longer than just digital changes inside your company. Earlier today, we spoke about autonomous car, charging, parking, also about considering, you know, the environment earlier, before, if we don't have any driver. Everything is here about how to consider your environment, your connected environment. And the knowledge is the basis. I have one more slide to show you because we're out of time. This slide, you can make a picture, everyone. Blockchain today is all about education. Here, we are all getting started. We're all at the same level. It's not because the industry of blockchain is like between 6 and 9 years old. It's everything has to be started from scratch and to be built from the inside, and not to, you know, to get, you know, from others. If you consider making any blockchain, any integration, again, you have to build it from scratch with the experts. Just a few words about the organization. Blockchain Israel is today an organization non-for-profit. We have 2,000 members. We started a year ago. Every month and plus minus, we are making events around how to entertain more people inside the blockchain. Well, we have a hackathon in 2 weeks. I'm super excited about it, which is like the first step of our long-term relationship with EcoMotion. It's gonna happen on 12, 13. Everyone is like invited to participate, of course. And that's it. Thank you. And if you have any questions,
So I hope you, everyone, found this morning insightful. I know I learned a few things, and we wanted to thank you. And also, if there's any new startups in the blockchain field that are interested in mobility, are welcome to meet with EcoMotion and to speak about opportunities, and also connect with the Volkswagen Group, which is now in Israel, to connect you to all the brands.
All right, I'm just building on this. Thank you, Oli. Thank you for having. Being here, what I also want to emphasize, because we're a small team, but we're really committed and interested, and we have a website. So it is connect-vwgroup.com, and you can register there as a startup. So this is for us the platform where we look for startups, for technologies, because what we get is a brief from our Volkswagen Group brands, and we want to do more of those meetups. We want to have delegations coming here, project teams. So it's very important that we find the right startups, the right technologies, and this is for us the platform there as well. And we're also discussing to do another breakfast meetup, because I think this was really a success, so thank you. We're thinking about the topic, digital marketing meets mobility, smart mobility, so that is... Yeah, so we're open to discuss with you while we continue mingling, what other topics you are interested in. So yes, we're here, we're committed, and we're so happy we had such a great morning, great day. Thank you. Right, so we can stay here. We can still have time for mimosa and mingling. We use the time, enjoy the morning, and thank you all for coming.